You'll remember from last lecture, Gwendolyn Brooks, what I think at least is a haunting poem. We real cool. We real cool, we left school. We lurk late, we strike straight. We sing sin, we thin gin, we jazz June. We die soon. Written in 1966, but really stands in for, in so many ways, this fundamental shift that I've been talking about the last couple of lectures in sort of the mentality from mid-1960s heading into the end of the 1960s. And that's where we are in the course right now. For this lecture, will be the last heavily focused on the 1960s, although it will come up again in next week's lectures. It will only be coming up really in fleeting fashion. So really, we're beginning to move out of the 1960s with this lecture. We've been lingering over this period, this decade, for essentially 3 weeks, 2.5 weeks of the course, in no small measure because it is the famous height of the Civil Rights Movement, but because, and even though I've been trying to rewrite that narrative for you, the fact is there are so many different competing lines of activism, of change, of struggle, of frustration, political brinksmanship of all different sorts, all really captured in this moment. Moments of great promise, followed by moments of great confusion, moments of great promise again, moments of great confusion and then despair. Overwhelmingly, the story of the late 1960s is one of political and cultural confusion, and one striking moment of anxiety is far too polite a word to put on it, but real fear about where this country's headed, or how it's going to get to where it should be headed. The barometer, as I pointed out quite some time ago, for a lot of these changes in the 1960s is the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. I want to start there by telling you the end of SNCC's story, essentially. So you remember that SNCC was founded out of the sit-in movements in 1960, college-age students in Shaw, North Carolina. It was brought under the wing of, or organized under the wing of the SCLC, embraced an integrationist ethos, respectability was at its core, belief in group-centered leadership, and is dedicated to civil rights education, whether it's voter registration, leadership training, et cetera. In the early 1960s. The cracks start to appear in as it struggled to find its own voice, feeling smothered by King's presence. Selma, the famous Bloody Sunday march that SNCC led in Tuesday Turnaround that King orchestrated without SNCC's awareness or knowledge, marked a fundamental break in the between those two organizations. SNCC then goes on a journey over the next handful of years about what it's going to be and how it's going to run. It's caught up in the black power passion of the time. Stokely Carmichael consolidates leadership within his very charismatic self-representation. SNCC kicks whites out of the movement, forms a temporary alliance through Carmichael's doing with the Black Panthers, but SNCC is too radical for the Panthers on race lines. I'll come back, overlap a few little details in today's lecture about this, but essentially, Carmichael leaves SNCC. He has no future there, and he leaves the country, and reasons I'll get to later on in the lecture. In the leadership void left behind by Carmichael, you have a cadre of different leaders battling it out, who's going to be the person representing SNCC. Meanwhile, the organization's infiltrated by the FBI. Seeds of doubt are sown left and right. And the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee changes its name to the Student National Coordinating Committee. In the height of late 1960s violence, which is part of the theme of this lecture, it disavows nonviolence as a solution, or as a tactic, or as a belief system. All bets are off. So it goes from nonviolent civil disobedience, integration ethos, to an all-black organization far more progressive than it was when it started, and eschewing nonviolence as a core mission. Leadership gets broken up, different kinds of battles, FBI infiltrates it successfully, And by 1973, with leadership in disarray, scattered throughout the globe, actually, the FBI closes the file on SNCC. There's nothing else left of the organization. SNCC is a metaphor for the great successes and great failures and great anxieties of the 1960s. This was a decade of great crescendos and great collapses. Great crescendos, of course, with embodied in King and his dream, embodied in signing the Civil Rights Act and the Voting Rights Act. But as we've seen, immediately after these crescendos, great collapses. Four young girls blown up in Birmingham, riots in Watts. So you arrive at the moment, and this is where the lecture really begins. This is all preface. You arrive at the moment of 1966. After Selma, King casting about, I think is really the fair word to use, casting about for the next step of the movement. Selma was, even though SNCC was furious with King, the successful, the final march was remains one of the great iconic moments of the sort of the famous narrative of the Civil Rights Movement. But it became just profoundly clear to King, and to others, of course, that these great changes in law, the great changes in national consciousness, were overwhelmingly seen as southeastern phenomenon, southeastern United States phenomenon. This is where the problem was. You saw in Watts, the problem was something quite different. You see in the great northern cities of the country, the problem's really quite different. They have these laws in the books already. And King decides to go to Chicago in 66 to try to address some of these deeply woven, deeply embedded problems that ran along racial lines in the great cities of the North and the Northeast. This is where the next stage of the Civil Rights Movement is going to be fought, according to King. King had been talking about, from the beginning of his rise to national prominence, he had been talking about economics and poverty. However, at this moment, 66, partly out of a result of searching for the next great agenda for the movement, partly out of the shifting logics of how the U.S. economy is functioning on a global scale, partly out of the radicalism and the internationalist radicalism that starts being articulated more aggressively by SNCC and would soon be articulated by the Black Panther Party with its Marxist ideology, King really starts to emphasize poverty. This is the next frontier of the movement. This is what we need to address. So King goes to Chicago, takes the SCLC with him, the Southern Christian Leadership Conference with him, and sees in Chicago de facto housing segregation, limited educational opportunities. He sees Chicago as, or the way life is lived in Chicago, as a manifestation of economic exploitation, pure and simple. As manifested, grows out of, is part of the housing problems, educational opportunity differential, manifested in trade unions, in the way in which trade unions kept the color line intact. It's manifested in real estate, who could live where. It's manifested in banks, the kind of loans you can get if you can get loans. Mortgage companies, slum landlords, the welfare system, federal agencies, courts, police, political system, the city administration. It was systemic, economic exploitation, the way it was witnessed, the way it was experienced in Chicago. So King and SCLC moves from a rather point-specific series of campaigns about voter registration drives, for instance, campaigns related to racial discrimination written in the law books, segregation written, you know, de jure into the law books, and recognize we've got a much bigger problem here. The diversity of the agenda that King starts to pursue when he's looking at economic exploitation and all the different places in which it makes itself known in Chicago, it's the diversity of the nature of the problem ultimately turns into King's undoing in Chicago. Chicago is giving away the punchline, a moment of profound failure for King. So King is in Chicago, setting up shop, and by July, midsummer, things are organized enough, and he prepared enough logistically, he organizes a march. He takes several thousand marchers to City Hall in Chicago, and much like his namesake, quite some time ago, tacks 24 demands to the door. Demands called for an end to racial discrimination in the kinds of institutions I mentioned just a moment ago. It was actually not much more than a publicity stunt that King hoped would create space for him at the bargaining table with Chicago's Mayor Richard Daley. A month later, following getting an audience with Daley, King presents a 10-point plan on housing. Daley works with the plan. They sign this plan together, and it's calling for open housing reform. So it seems like King's made some difference already. Daley's a staunch Democrat, but really embodied, I mean, he owned Chicago politics. Heck, he owned state politics. And King got Daley to sign this pledge for housing reform. But signing a pledge isn't really doing anything except for putting your name on a piece of paper. You got to put political will behind it. And Daley didn't want to expend any of it when it came to enforcement. So King's earliest efforts in Chicago are merely symbolic efforts. It's not actually creating change. Now, Chicago locals were very excited about King's arrival and his abiding presence. He's staying in town. Black Chicagoans believed that now that King was there, the city and the country would pay attention to the problems that Black faced on a daily basis. But the excitement begins to fade just as quickly as it is built up. Bless you. Locals begin to realize that King's not really well suited for the complexities of the Northern Black world. And that sounds kind of condescending. I'm not talking about, you know, does he know how to, you know, buy a loaf of bread and how to, you know, act properly. That's not it at all. The problem is that King is used to, because of the legal structures of discrimination in the South, used to a very simple political landscape. Blacks had no voting presence. They had no representational presence. There were local activists, certainly, but they were not emboldened in the way to, I mean, they did not have the kind of support network behind them to catapult things to the national scene. That's not the case in Chicago. Chicago had significantly more diverse populations within the Black community, just in the city itself, than any single place King had been before and tried to wage a campaign. There were many other people who were established leaders in the community, were recognized as such, and they had their access to Mayor Daley. And King comes in and wants to have access by himself, not understanding the political theater that defines Chicago. To put it in his most simple way, King comes into Chicago and without realizing it, starts stepping on the toes of all these other Black leaders who are already in place, who had their organizations, who had their movements, and who had access. Now, the real split between Chicagoans and King happens in a swirl of events that surround a march into Cicero, one of Chicago's most famously all-white enclaves. King organizes a march to call attention, like he's done on so many other occasions, to systemic discrimination, the way it's been embodied in Chicago. And then at the last minute tries to cancel it when Daley agrees to sign a new housing plan. The activists who had committed themselves to the march were furious and decided to proceed without King. And right there, there's the difference. In the case of, think back to Selma, just a year earlier, slightly more than a year earlier, Bloody Sunday followed Tuesday turnaround. Chicagoans saying, there will be no turnaround. We've seen you do this before, and we're not going to abide by it up in Chicago. It's also important, so the local activists decide we're going to march without King. We don't care if he signed anything with the mayor. Now, what's also important to realize is that the Chicago activists were not trained in a culture of nonviolent civil rights activism. Now, I think I've already mentioned before, there was a lot of violence in the civil rights movement. Violence on all sides. But there was also a commitment, a rhetorical and then a lived commitment to nonviolent tradition. One clip, I'm sorry I didn't get the chance to show you, when it came to Freedom Summer, black and white students coming down to Mississippi and having to walk through gauntlets where they're actually beaten by fellow activists to get them ready for what might happen in Mississippi. And if they started to fight back, they couldn't go out in the field. I mean, the training was literally bruising. Chicagoans didn't have that training. So you have an untrained but politically experienced and savvy group, a diverse group of activists coming together to march on Cicero. A lot of anger, a lot of fear as a result. Knowing all these different factors are in place, the National Guard is brought in immediately. We're not even going to wait for a riot to happen. We're going to start with the National Guard being in place. The National Guard is there to ensure that the march proceeds peacefully. But in a telling sign, the guardmen's rifles are with fixed bayonets are pointed at the marchers instead of at the hecklers who line the street to protest the march's arrival. So the marchers are walking through a gauntlet of guardsmen there to protect them, but the marchers are facing the bayonets and the rifles. Well, the march proceeds, but then hecklers who are there behind the National Guard line start throwing rocks and bottles, and most of the marchers start returning fire. Now, it's nothing short of a miracle. The march does not explode into a riot, but didn't accomplish anything either. I guess it accomplished the fact that King's leadership style was really, at that point, now considered irrelevant in Chicago. Now, I simplified the story about King in Chicago for the sake of time, but this is the core fact, is that King comes to Chicago as the testing ground for his new campaign to bring attention to economic exploitation. It's part of his new agenda relating to poverty, or his more clearly articulated agenda relating to poverty. And his organization and his style just don't work. They don't line up with the structured politics in a place like Chicago. Now, complicating things further in all of this, especially for King, is the escalating war in Vietnam. I've made allusions to it a couple times already. But now we're at a point of crisis for King. He is a pronounced pacifist. He's always against the war. But he had kept his opinions quiet in order to ensure successes in the civil rights agenda and the different battles he was fighting up to that point. King starts to wrestle openly with what he sees as the immorality happening over in Southeast Asia, that he's silent on that regard, on that front, that he's talking about the immorality of the economic system in the United States. He couldn't reconcile the two. Meanwhile, King's fellow civil rights leaders make a point of talking King out of making a public announcement against the Vietnam War. So King, really seen as the leader of the movement, there's a lot of air quotes there, the leader of the movement, he's really one of equals of the leaders of several other major civil rights organizations, the National Urban League, the NAACP most famously. And they're now trying to silence him, saying you cannot risk everything we've been fighting for for this war someplace else. One such leader, Whitney Young of the National Urban League, advised King to, quote, leave the war to the experts, and that, quote, the Negro was more concerned about the rat at night and the job in the morning. Young, Whitney Young, I should point out, was pulled aside King at Lyndon Johnson's insistence. The White House had been working closely with these leaders now for years, working with John F. Kennedy before he's assassinated. He's, you know, trying to convince them to change their agenda in certain ways for the sake of a civil rights bill success. But they're working with John F. Kennedy. They're working with Lyndon Baines Johnson. And this in and itself is a radical shift. I mean, think back to 1941 when A. Philip Randolph bluffs his way basically into a meeting with FDR. Now, leaders of civil rights organizations are called into the Oval Office frequently. How can we manage this crisis? I need your advice on this, that, or the other. Well, Johnson, who's finding himself now stuck in Vietnam and trying to find a way out, although he's escalating it, Johnson tells the civil rights leaders, hearing rumors about King's increasing confusion, it's not really the word I want to use, confusion about the war, or at least the public agenda. LBJ tells the civil rights leaders, if you break with me on Vietnam, I will close my door to you. I mean, LBJ is no stranger to brinksmanship. He's an expert at it. And he essentially threatens the civil rights leaders with killing their agenda if they try to get their fingers involved in what he sees as his agenda. It's the war in Vietnam. As we move through 1966 and into 1967, I mean, King got the message. He knows he's not supposed to say anything. But he finds that he can no longer be quiet about this. And he starts giving talks, mostly in the South, about the war in Vietnam. You know, much like the famous I Have a Dream speech, where, you know, we only get the short excerpt that makes us all feel really wonderful, and we don't get the excerpts that make us feel, well, pretty bad. King is giving, I mean, so the basic speech is much longer than what we know. King is giving not even sermons, lectures that are 45, 50 minutes long, talking about structural inequality, economic super-exploitation, the immorality of the Cold War battles being played out, well, anywhere, but especially in the developing world. Given the kind of lecture you expect from a political scientist or an economist, and the kind of detail in political economy, he's testing out the ground, basically. And in the spring of 1967, he's invited to speak at Riverside Church in Manhattan with a long tradition of progressivism. And he famously breaks the silence. I mean, he'd been breaking the silence for months now, but now it's on this national platform. And so on April 4th, 1967, King steps to the pulpit of Riverside Church saying that he felt he could no longer be silent. And he declares that the Great Society has been shot down. Lyndon Johnson's Great Society's effort to, you know, fight a war on poverty, that the Great Society has been shot down on the battlefields of Vietnam. It would be very inconsistent for me to teach and preach nonviolence in this situation and then applaud violence when thousands and thousands of people are being maimed and mutilated and many killed in this war. Now, King is talking about Vietnamese being killed. He's also talking about American soldiers being killed. And it's a theme that you hear more from people on the street who are very angry. I didn't bring this in a different lecture, but the statistics are rather stark about who's going off to fight in Vietnam and who's actually in the positions of most danger and who's dying. The poor, regardless of the race, and African Americans, in numbers far disproportionate to the representation in the U.S. public. The poor and blacks are the ones that are in the most dangerous positions and essentially become cannon fodder in the killing fields. So, you know, King is not on his own amongst black leaders of being horrified, and black citizens of being horrified at what's happening in Vietnam. He decides to break his silence.
I've chosen to preach about the war in Vietnam today because I agree with Dante that the hottest places in hell are reserved for those who, in a period of moral crisis, maintain their neutrality. There comes a time when silence is betrayal. The truth of these words is beyond doubt, but the mission to which they call us is the most difficult one, even when pressed by the demands of inner truth. Men do not easily assume the task of opposing their government's policy, especially in time of war. Nor does the human spirit move without great difficulty. Against all the apathy of conformist thought within one's own bosom and in the surrounding world. Moreover, when the issues at hand seem as perplexing as they often do in the case of this dreadful conflict, we are always on the verge of being mesmerized by uncertainty, but we must move on. Some of us who have already begun to break the silence of the night have found that the calling to speak is often a vocation of agony. But we must speak. We must speak with all the humility that is appropriate to our limited vision, but we must speak.
And as I've already alluded to, or mentioned a few moments ago, King continues to speak about the linkages between, in the speech, about the linkages between capitalist economies, their imperialist tendencies, and the war in Southeast Asia. This was not a King that the national public knew, didn't recognize this person. And this was also not a King that LBJ was going to tolerate. He immediately distances himself from King, just as he threatened to do. He followed through. The White House is now closed to King and SCLC. Now, just as this is not a King that people recognized for his sort of laser-like focus on the political economy, hypercapitalism, it's a King that's not been memorialized for all of us. So it brings us back to something I've been talking about, is the issues of how we remember, how we've been taught to remember the civil rights movement and what those national narratives do as far as how we interpret our own notion of what makes a citizen. It's a period of incredible anxiety. Urban violence is spreading unchecked. In Detroit, 35 people die in a huge race riot. In Newark, nearly as many as are left dead. I mean, Newark's seen as an incredible battle zone. The statistics of the amount of bullets that were fired by the police state is rather astonishing. The order of thousands upon thousands compared to the number of shots fired by those people who are rioting. And as you know, Newark is still struggling with the legacy of of what happened in the 1960s, the late 60s. It's a city still on its mend. In early 1968, little less than a year after he comes out against the Vietnam War, King issues a call for a massive protest event called the Poor People's Campaign. It's an event that would take place in Washington, D.C., and would call national and hopefully international attention to the plight of the poor, regardless of color. At the same time that King is developing the logistics for this campaign, he agrees to lend his support to a strike by sanitation workers in Memphis, Tennessee. Sanitation workers were clamoring for union recognition, and the city's black community, this is largely a black force, and the city's black community lent its hearty support. The mayor refused to acknowledge the black workers. An economic boycott followed that almost crippled the city. And a riot was barely averted, despite the fact that citizens essentially began to attack the police on one occasion. This heightened era of urban violence and systemic economic exploitation, King comes to Memphis in March and tries to rally the public. He has to leave town very quickly, but he returns. He said he's going to return in 10 days, and he vowed that he would stay put, which is not something that King did, but he would stay put in Memphis until the workers were recognized. On April 3rd, King speaks to an audience at a nighttime rally. Now, it's important to understand, by this point in his young life, and he really was a young man, King was frustrated and dismayed. The civil rights establishment figures with whom he had grown up politically, that he had led, essentially, the establishment figures had now distanced themselves from him. The White House had cut him off, and this is always his trump card. You remember back when John F. Kennedy was running for the White House, they used each other to sort of pull attention to troubled situations in the South, in Birmingham, most famously. But the White House is now closed to him, and since the successes of 63, 64, and 65, King had only been met with a series of setbacks. Now he's struggling mightily to pull off a new direction in his public activism via the Poor People's Campaign, sort of bringing together his racial worldviews and his class worldviews. For months leading up to this April 3rd speech, King had been walking around in sort of a daze. I mean, if you've seen, I've been trying for years to find this movie again. King gives a speech at Stanford University. I want to say 67, I'm not quite sure of the year, but it's between 67, maybe early 68. And it's a film, they filmed the speech from beginning to end. And it is a King that we are not used to seeing. I mean, he is flat out exhausted and depressed. And you only get to some moments, four-fifths of the way through of this hour-long speech or so, where you get these recognizable moments of oratorical flight. But the rest of it, he's just despairing about the human condition. People have been worried about him, working himself to the state of exhaustion, wondering about his spirit. They're disturbed by the fact that he'd been having visions of his own death, literally thinking that his time on earth was actually limited. He's giving the speech on April 3rd, trying to rally the Memphis sanitation workers in the community. And then towards the end of his speech, he turns his attention to his own mortality and his notions of how long he might be on this planet.
And some began to say the threats, or talk about the threats that were out, or what would happen to me from some of our sick white brothers. Well, I don't know what will happen now. We've got some difficult days ahead. But it really doesn't matter with me now, because I've been to the mountaintop. I don't mind. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And he's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you. But I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land.
would be the last speech that King would give. The next afternoon, April 4th, 1968, a year to the date after he comes out against the Vietnam War at Riverside Church, he's assassinated. As news of King's death races across the country, cities go up in flames. Uprisings occur in over 100 cities. Over 50 people are killed collectively. Thousands are injured. 70,000 troops are called out around the country to restore order. Large sections of cities like Chicago and Washington, D.C. are wiped out. Chicago's mayor, so recently an ally of King, terrified of what's going to happen in the wake of this assassination, terrified, angry, gives his police the order to shoot to kill. I know from personal experience, having done a lot of research for my dissertation and first book, Washington, D.C., at Howard University, these riots happened in 1968. Areas around Howard were still burned out in the early 1990s. I mean, still. If you've been down to Washington, D.C. in the last 6 or 7 years, the city that you see in those areas, around U Street, east of DuPont Circle, north of the Capitol, those areas are unrecognizable. The change or the restoration of those parts of the city took well over 30 years. Now, King's death is one of the most important moments in a year of real horror. 1968, students on many university campuses radicalize, joining new protest movements, taking over campus buildings. If you look at the buildings of the early 1970s, you can tell it's basically riot architecture. You know, large stone buildings with very small windows that chairs cannot be thrown through. Radical black workers organize into the Dodge Revolutionary Union Movement, the critique of its economic exploitation. LBJ announces that he will not run for re-election. Robert F. Kennedy is assassinated the night he wins the California Democratic primary. Democratic National Convention is held in Chicago. It's a convention marred by police rioting. You know, they batter demonstrators and reporters on a daily basis. COINTELPRO, the counterintelligence program, is trained upon black radicals, starts beating up on the Black Panthers, one of the groups that J. Edgar Hoover called hate group. Starts infiltrating SNCC, and begins to break that organization up. Around the world, the French government collapses when 9 million workers stage a general strike against Charles de Gaulle, only to have the country's armed forces mobilized to restore order. In Mexico, the government ordered its troops to fire upon hundreds of student protesters who were trying to call attention to their plight in the weeks preceding the start of the Mexico City Olympics. Famously, Tommy Smith and John Carlos, sprinters for the U.S. Olympic team, give the famous Black Power salute when they're on the medal stand, stripped of their medals. Richard Nixon narrowly defeats Democratic candidate Hubert Humphrey for president, and Nixon wins by brokering a deal with Strom Thurmond, this powerful senator from South Carolina, promising Thurmond that he would lay off the South in regards to civil rights if Thurmond would deliver Southern votes to Nixon instead of to the third party candidate George Wallace, who happens to get nearly 10 million votes, by the way. In the midst of all this confusion, King's assassination, Stokely Carmichael, who I've already mentioned, is seen as being the heir apparent to the civil rights leadership pantheon, you know, the next great black leader. He's isolated, essentially not in the Panthers, he's isolated from SNCC, but people are still thinking that he might be the one to take up King's mantle. But in the wake of King's assassination, and D.C. going up in flames especially, people start blaming Carmichael for the riot, for fanning the hysteria about the riot that turns into the riot, and start blaming him for not being able to restore order. And Carmichael actually flees the country and essentially lives in exile the rest of his life. The quote job, and I really put big quotes around it, the job of leading Black America is unstaffed and maybe unmanageable. In the wake of King's assassination, as the riots are cooling down, leaders start to, the other leaders of civil rights organizations, people in King's inner circles, saying, what are we going to do to honor King? What can we do? The world is in disarray. Well, there was the Poor People's Campaign. And they decide, you know, to honor King's legacy, we're going to carry forth that campaign. They see it as a real opportunity to marry race politics with class politics. So they start organizing a plan to bring poor people from 10 cities and 5 rural districts to Washington, D.C. and stay for 3 months, calling attention to their daily plight and calling for a $30 billion anti-poverty package that included a commitment to full employment, a guaranteed annual income, and increased construction of low-income housing. In mid-May, the first wave of demonstrators arrive in D.C., and 1 week later, Resurrection City, a tent city, is built on the Washington Mall, settlement of tents and shacks to house the protesters. But the campaign is hobbled by events that are beyond its control. It's hoping for 1,500 protesters to come to D.C., but 7,000 come instead. During the midst of the campaign, Robert Kennedy is assassinated, which completely distracts the government from the activists in its midst. And then the skies open up and turns Resurrection City into one big mud flat, and very quickly with escalating public health problems. There's not enough housing in tents. There's not enough essentially porta potties. There's not enough way to feed these people. And the government, acting on concern for the activists' health, becomes an epidemiological nightmare. Close the camp after 1 month. So the Poor People's Campaign, we're going to be here for 3 months to raise, call attention to the plight of poor folks, becomes very successful in terms of the number of people. It overwhelms the logistics. And then Mother Nature intervenes. And for the health of the people, the government closes the camp after 1 month. This in the midst of all these catastrophes happening on the international stage. So we have at the end of 1968 a new era of national politics that marks the beginning of a backlash against civil rights gains and the articulation of policies that had no explicit racial reference but were clearly coded racially all the same. Nixon, as he's campaigning and brokering a deal with Strom Thurmond, campaigns on a law and order platform. Such a platform made plain that he would go after Black radicals and admittedly the degenerate hippies and anti-war activists who are destroying the country, in Nixon's view. Law and order. We're going to get this house back in shape. This is the state of affairs that leads us out of the 1960s into the 1970s. The country's damaged profoundly. Its confidence is shaken. And it's about to get worse, actually. I want to play for you 2 clips that underscore the tenor of the time. This is an era, of great political turmoil, but also an era of incredible cultural production. I mean, astonishing. The Beatles go from yeah, 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 no matter who they might have ripped it off from, according to Eldridge Cleaver, to the incredible studio albums of the late 60s. Rock and roll, Motown, all of these things mature in a way. This is on the stage of the most important sort of cultural consumptive moments that people had seen. But closer to the ground, you have a marriage of black activism and anger and cultural production that tells a story of despair. These are two clips by spoken word artist Gil Scott-Heron. I'll let them run into the one into the other. The first one is an excerpt from his performance piece called The Revolution Will Not Be Televised. The next one, a cult critique of economic exploitation and the space race while ignoring folks on the ground. It's called Whitey on the Moon. A lot of his lyrics talking about, you know, corporate capitalism, you know, talking about all these ad campaigns, the tiger in your tank referring to Exxon and talking about scope and bad breath. I mean, he's fighting against what he would consider the square corporate culture of Madison Avenue and what they're trying to sell to the American people. They picked an interesting moment to walk in, didn't they? Anyway, we're going to pick up at that moment of cultural challenge and anger and power when we reconvene on Monday morning. Have a great weekend.